When you're traveling somewhere, it helps if you know where you're going. Maybe you know someone who regularly sets off without knowing exactly where they're going and so gets horrendously lost on the way. I've had several incidents. I remember when I lived in London, going to meet some friends, and they said, "Yeah, we'll be going for drinks after work on Horse Ferry Road." Now, maybe you know that Horse Ferry Road is quite a famous road in Westminster, where I think there used to be a famous magistrates' court on there that appeared on the news a lot. So Horse Ferry Road, people would know where that is. Certainly if you're travelling there for drinks after work, you should look and see. But there's also another Horse Ferry Road, it turns out, in Greenwich, which is a 40-minute train journey away. Guess which one I went to? Well, maybe you or someone you know also can set off without knowing where they're going. It's madness, right? Pardon me. It's madness, right, in geographical terms. But when you commit yourself to serve the Lord, you cannot know all of the details, or in some cases, even the destination of where He will lead you. Well, it's very foolish to set off to meet friends without knowing where you're going. It's not foolish to serve God in faith, like Abraham. When God called Abraham, he came from a family of idol worshippers, who didn't know the Lord. Yet when Abraham heard God telling him to leave his family and to move to another country that God would show him later, Abraham just did it. He left. He didn't know where God was leading him, but he went because God told him to go. And that's faith. Today, I want us to look at the kind of life God is calling us to, and to see that trusting God for what we cannot see is the only true way of faith. The only way of faith that honours Christ. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, the Lord said to Abraham, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you." The land I will show you. Abraham didn't know it. He wasn't familiar with it. He wasn't choosing it for himself. God would lead him there. Living by faith is being willing to go when God clearly tells you to go, even when you don't know where or what or when or how before you take your first step in obeying God. I want to say that so often we want to plan everything. We want to know the ins and outs, to know the costs, to know that we've got everything within our capacity to deal with, and that we're not going to be exposing ourselves to risk. Many of us like to operate like that, and yet God calls us to take that step and to obey Him even when we don't know where or what or when or how things are going to go. Take the issue of money. We like to have that sorted before we go. House. We want to know where we're going to live and how, and that that's all going to be okay. Food. That we'll have all that sorted. And then there's the sort of anxieties of the modern parent in the UK today. Friends for us, we want a good social network. Friends for our kids as well, we want to be assured of that. We want to be around people like us in a culture where we fit. But what did Abraham and Sarah have? Did they have surety that money would be provided for them? Well, no mistake. It seems that Abraham is a wealthy guy. He's going off with the possessions that they'd accumulated, verse 5, and the people they'd accumulated. And so we're not claiming that he's a pauper. But yet they're going into the land of the Canaanites, verse 6, which is a risky thing to do. So he will be exposing himself to financial risk. Will these people trade with him? Will he lose possessions? Financial risk. Did he know about money in advance? No. House and everything sorted? No. Lived in tents, as we're told in Hebrews chapter 11. Food and things that he would need each day? No, that wouldn't be sorted either. He'd have to trust God for that. Friends? Well, actually, there were enemies living in the land. People and culture like him? No, they were foreigners, and he'd have to go and be the Lord's representative. You see, a false idol of worship is the thing that you will not give up for Jesus. And so many of us have tried to make deals with the Lord where we say, Yeah, you can ask me to do this or that, but not these things here. I won't give these up. But the Lord asks us to do just that, and he sent Abraham. God will be asking some of us to move countries for the sake of the gospel, to move towns for the gospel, or to a different kind of town, a different kind of area of a town. Maybe to walk across the street and make a friend when we find those things hard, but God's telling us to knock on a door perhaps and give a good news newspaper. He's certainly asking all of us to step out of our comfort and easy living. The Lord wanted to bless the world through Abraham. We see this in chapter 12, verses 2 to 3. I'll make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I'll make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you, and all people on earth will be blessed through you. So Abraham, by going, it was stepping into blessing, although it looked risky. And as we obey the Lord and listen to his voice, that we'll be blessed as we go. It's the one place of safety to walk with the Lord. There's nowhere safer. Nowhere safer. And if we don't go, we'll close ourselves off from being blessed and from being a blessing to others, which I take it we want to be if we're followers of Christ. Make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. You know, obviously, we're not Abraham. We're not the sort of center of God's salvation plan as he was in Genesis there. So we don't want dreams of grandeur like that. But the Lord will call us, and he asks us to participate in what he's doing and taking the gospel out. And he still speaks today and sends individuals to do specific things. So we're not Abraham, but the path of faith is the path of the cross and loss. We don't want it to be that, but it is. It's the path of cross and loss, not accumulation and comfort. It's the path where we're more concerned about Jesus's voice than our comfort. And I find that challenging because I'm a great believer in my own comfort, and I'll engineer things around me so often so that I can just be comfortable. Live long and prosper. But the Lord calls us. You know, at the age of 16, as I became a believer in the Lord Jesus, I felt the Lord call me to be a minister of the gospel. And I remember speaking to my parents about that at the time. A few years later, I remember him speaking to me and saying, it's now. Go and do this now, even though I had other career plans, but he wanted me to put them to the side. And would I go and do that straight away and go and offer myself for that? A few years later, again, he asked Mim and I to come to Cumbria, and it was about obeying his voice and going. Now, Cumbria is actually quite a nice place to come to, isn't it? But the important thing was to say, we can hear the Lord. Putting this before us, are we going to obey him, or maybe the things that are even being said around us about why not this or that, this more comfortable room? You know, and I just wish in my life that I'd listened to the other things that the Lord had asked me to do, the times I've missed great opportunities, the times I've been overcautious, the times I've loved my own life more than that of Christ. Now, the book of Hebrews tells us that Abraham went to a place he would later receive as his inheritance. He obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going, and he was prepared to live like a stranger. And to express that, Abraham lived in a tent, and so did Isaac and Jacob, because they believed God's promise that God was going to give them the land of Canaan. Living as a stranger is something that's still open to us, whereby we can not just settle into the culture and blend into the background. Even if we're from that culture, we can still live as a stranger by establishing a different set of priorities, giving our money to the work of the gospel, giving our time to the work of the gospel, allowing us and our family to experience cost for the work of the gospel in emotional and time and energy terms. Taking up the spade, if you like, and doing some hard digging work rather than sitting back and just looking for ease. To follow Jesus wherever he leads means that you have to be prepared to do the thing that that so many of us hate in our affluent culture, which is be prepared to give up control, be prepared to give up predictability, ease, and familiarity. These were all things that Abraham did when he obeyed the voice of the Lord and when he entered the school of Christ, we might say, and let Jesus teach him, and followed the Lord who had spoken to him and promised him that he would give him descendants more numerous than the stars of the sky. Those things couldn't be discerned by logic and common sense and asking his neighbor what he thought, but by listening to the voice of the Lord. It's the best way to live. So Abraham and Sarah were prepared to give up control, predictability, ease, and familiarity. How do you live courageously like this? How do you have such a vision of Christ that consistently works its way out through life? Well, perhaps this will help us. Three questions with three answers that need to blossom in your heart to live courageously. Here's the first question. Who am I? How you answer that question is really important. And I think the answer goes something like this. For me, I'm a son of the living God, an heir of the promise, as it says in Hebrews 11 verse 9. That's how Abraham and the others lived, as heirs of the promise. I've been created by God for a relationship with him. I am not an accident. God has placed me where I am. So who am I? It's so important we can answer that. How would you answer that question? Secondly, we need to answer this question and have the answer blossom in our heart. What is my purpose? And our purpose ought to be to live by faith as a foreigner, as a stranger in a foreign country, Hebrews 11 verse 9, saying, this world is not my home. I'm here to bring glory to God and to show how good and lovely he is. And I wonder what it is that the Lord might call you to. What would be your expression of serving him, whereby you hear his call and go, what is he inviting you to do? He's given you certain gifts. He's given you certain people you can actually connect with and desires. Wait on him in prayer. Where is he leading you? Some of you will feel like you've wasted some of your best years. Well, what about now? What is our gracious God inviting you to do now? Whatever you do, do it with all your heart. Live like a foreigner here. The third question that you need to be able to answer is, what is my destiny? It tells us in Hebrews 11, verse 6, that Abraham was looking forward to the city whose architect and builder is God. A better country, a heavenly one, it tells us in that chapter. That's what he was looking forward to. So the new creation, not just the land of the Canaanites that the Lord had promised him, but he knew that that was down payment for, that it was a guarantee of the heavenly city that the Lord was going to build. And so he knew that it wasn't all about now and feeding his physical needs now, doing all his life goal stuff now, because there was a better place coming. And the strange effect of that is that as you have a loose hold on things now, you're actually free to enjoy them more. As you say, there will be a better time of relationship and celebration and of fun and of exploration and of everything good and of comfort in the new creation with Jesus. It liberates us. So important to be able to ask, who am I? What is my purpose? What is my destiny? Can you answer those questions? I invite you to be able to do that and to be able to find rock solid answers to them. And really, the ultimate answer to that comes through Christ, because he's our maker. And when we understand this, we then realize that we're connected to him and we have a debt to him that we joyfully want to pay. So don't live disconnectedly from the reality of God's plan now for the world. connect with it by being able to answer those questions. Don't just live in a meandering, aimless way. Connect with God's plan for this world and for you. To live courageously for Christ, you need to know these things. It will enable you to take risks as well. So the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. Navigation, it's so important to know where you're headed to and how you're going to get there. But when we follow Christ during this life now, he's going to call us to take steps where we don't yet have the provision that we need, but we know that he will provide it along the way. He will ask us to take steps that perhaps our peers never would, because they're too busy investing here. He wants us to invest in the heavenly country. Don't store up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. All those things can be taken, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. That's the call of faith. To go, even when you don't have all the details of how you'll get there or even the destination. May God grant you, in his great kindness, that kind of faith. Amen.